My guest today had correctly called $1,900 gold and above. So where does he see the metal now? Where does he see Bitcoin? Where does he see silver? Where does he see the future? He is the author of his new book, Why Gold, Why Now? E.B. Tucker, welcome to my new show.
Thanks for having me.
Well, thank you for joining me. The last time we spoke, I was at my former network, and that's where you called $1,900 gold. You feeling good with that call?
Well, we already beat that. So let's go back in time, because you and I have done this for years now. It's kind of as much fun as guessing someone's weight at the state fair. We did 1500 right. And we hit that. We did 1900 and we hit that. Now, I don't want to shock you, but 2500 by the end of the year. I don't know if we'll stay above that, but I think we'll hit that. And we feel really confident. Everyone has been asking the last few weeks, you know, the chart is right here behind me. But look, I mean, anybody that read my book sees that this is coming in dominoes. So you're going to have numerous dominoes have to fall. And we're only about three innings into the baseball game. I mean, there's six innings left to go. You got to know what's coming next. There's a lot that's coming next. The election is so bullish for gold. It doesn't matter what happens. A Trump victory for second term is bullish for gold in different ways, and a Biden victory is bullish for gold in other ways. You've got the U.S. Treasury just can't borrow enough money. I mean, they've never seen a dollar they didn't want to borrow, and you know, we can get into all that, but everything is set up, and I know the call is shocking from here, but let's see what happens.
Hold on. So I think it actually pales in comparison to a lot of the calls I've been hearing from people, which is, you know, $5,000, $10,000, $20,000 gold. What might be shocking is by year end.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. So we see the setup now. I mean, there's a lot of charting that goes into this. There's a lot of setup in the market. The entire gold market, every ounce of gold ever mined in human history is only worth $12 trillion. And so this year, you've seen, you know, $3 to $4 trillion in stimulus go out the door. Last night there was a call from the House for $2.2 trillion more. I mean, you're almost had a deficit in the U.S. of half the value of all the gold on the whole planet. So look, and a lot of things have happened. I mean, Buffett coming into gold. You know, I wrote in my book about Buffett's negative statements about gold. But why is he coming into gold? Because there's no return on cash. There's no return on bonds. The stock market is not appealing to anyone that's sensible. And you look at gold and you've just crossed off all the reasons he used to hate gold. I think other people are going to come to this conclusion, but let's make sure we focus on something. Gold is not an investment. It's an asset. So it's kind of a safe harbor. It's a place to park your boat while the storm comes through town. Okay. There's ways to make money. So we're talking about wealth preservation on one side, and let's talk about how to profit on another, because these are two very different things.
Okay, let me ask you this. Okay, there's a lot of good, I don't want to use the word nuggets, but nuggets in what you just said. But I've recently just had Michael Saylor on the show, and he moved his company's cash into crypto. I actually have Raul Powell coming on. He's also moving, you know, a huge position, 50% of his assets in Bitcoin. And when I asked them, well, why not gold? Their argument is, well, you could keep mining gold. You could pay enough money for someone to find that gold, but you can't do that with Bitcoin.
Maybe. I mean, but you can have Pierre Lassonde on your show. I'm sure he'll come on if you ask him, and he'll tell you that they haven't found a 50 million ounce deposit in a shockingly long time.
That's my answer to them. Yeah. But, you know, I guess
Let's get into that for a minute, because I talk about crypto in my book, and I think I do it in a very fair way, because there's a place where crypto's headed, and it's a place people haven't considered. And I wrote this in newsletters for a long time. I don't think people really fully caught on, so I devoted a big chunk of the book to it, because I don't think it ends well for crypto, and I think people need to really consider what I'm proposing there. But let's look at gold. Gold, you can melt it down. You can't trace it. You can turn it into belt buckles, teeth, jewelry, back into coins, back into bars, and you never know where it comes from. Crypto has ultimately got to go onto a network to be traded. Sure, you can store it cold in a safe on a thumb drive. Sure, you could trade it with someone off market. But as we saw with the kids that blackmailed Twitter accounts last year, earlier this year, that got crypto, they tracked that crypto down and found those. Okay, so my point is, do you want something that's out of the system? If you want something that's out of the system, pure unadulterated gold is the only asset in the world that has no counterparty. Bitcoin still relies on that network to be traded.
All right, EB Tucker, getting back to price predictions here. If you put gold at 2,500 by year end, where is silver?
$40. That's a strong call. I know it makes rattle some people a little bit. $40 for silver. I personally have that trade on in a major, major way. I know several others that do too. We see $40 silver. It's going to surprise people. Only 25% of silver comes from primary mining. That means it depends on other metals to be mined. A lot of those supplies aren't looking so good. And silver's been in a long, long bear market, and it's going to surprise people.
This is a fantastic read that you've put together, EB. I'm on my second time reading it again. It's good for people new to gold or who've been in this market for a long time. I want to focus on one of the chapters where you talk the Fed can't raise interest rates ever again. Why?
That's right. They can't do it. They absolutely can't do it. People need to understand this is a debt-based system. So we turned a corner years back. We started inflating the system like this. If you shrink, everything rattles, it falls apart. Companies can't refinance their bonds. People can't refinance their mortgages. Houses go down in value. Everything crumbles. Pension funds, you name it, top to bottom, everybody has a hard time. The system's got to grow. The question is, can they control the rate of inflation? That's the deal. If you look now, they're trying to get this 2% inflation target. They're going to have trouble getting it. Ultimately, they'll probably overshoot, but they'll do anything they can to get 2%. Why 2%? Because if you keep inflating, then it's easier to refinance the debt because over time you have growth. But remember something, that's nominal growth. So you have nominal growth and real growth. We don't have to get into it, but my point is the US is shrinking on a real basis and growing on a nominal basis. You've got to preserve your wealth. The book's subtitle, The War Against Your Wealth and How to Win It. That's the whole thing. I mean, it's right here below the thing. The War Against Your Wealth and How to Win It. This is a war against your wealth. And this is a situation where that's what we're talking about, is we're talking about how to preserve your wealth. And if you have even $1,000, that's wealth.
EB, I had Jim Rogers on who said, we don't have to fear 2020 when it comes to markets because politicians, the Fed will do whatever to keep this market alive and going ahead of the election. What we do need to fear is 2021. Do you agree with that statement?
Yeah, I mean, what's the plan after this? I mean, everything is we're patching holes in a situation that's taking on water. I mean, we've got external threats, we've got internal threats, people are out of work. Global tourism is over 10% of GDP. It's zero revenue. I mean, look, ask people, you know, in Italy, there's hotels empty, closing down. I mean, this, right. Look, I think that tourism right now reminds me of what I read about in finance school as wheat farmers in the 30s. I mean, in the 30s, it was the crash in the farming industry that really broke the system because all these people were unemployed. And that was the wave that took the country into Great Depression. But these days it's tourism. It's over 10% of the economy. And right now there's not a hotel that's full. I stayed in a hotel in Sarasota recently, 6% occupancy. How are you going to run a hotel with 6% occupancy? Impossible.
So on a scale of 1 to 10, in terms of ugliness here, how bad can this economy get? And how afraid are you, EB?
I'm not afraid of anything, I'm afraid of the dentist, but outside of that, I'm not afraid of anything. So what's going to happen here is they're going to continually plug and plug and plug and throw anything they can at this system to keep it going. So the fact is, if you totally pull out of all the markets, you could be in for a bad surprise. This is not a scenario where everything goes flat like a pancake. This is a scenario where you've got to protect some of your wealth. That's what Buffett did. You didn't see him go $130 billion into gold miners. You know, he went $500 million. And the fact is, you look at these companies, they're making tons of profit. They're increasing dividends. They have huge margins. And nobody has looked at them for years. And I had breakfast this morning with a guy from Fisher Investments. This guy was like, we don't even know who to call about gold. I mean, and it's not their fault. The reality is that nobody has even looked at this business in a long time. You've got Snowflake trading at 70 right. times revenue. Gold companies, you can't even sell these things. But believe me, when the dividends keep coming and the share prices keep going up, they're going to attract a lot of attention. But let's cover one more thing. How do you make money? Because, I mean, remember, you buy gold for 1880 and you ride it to 2500. It's okay. But the way you make money is the royalty business. And that's what we've done with Metalla. You know, we started at $1.20. We're at $12 now. It's been a great ride. You know, it continues to go on. The company is doing what it's done since day one.
Well, I, and just to go back to that point, maybe I shouldn't have used the word afraid, but I was speaking with one investor who had seen our last interview together, and he said, wow, you know, I'm really afraid because I had seen EB so rattled, and I don't think I've ever seen him so rattled. So that's why I asked.
Remember,
you
that was March. That was March when we were in a scenario.
So I asked
where,
you, are you more worried today than, let's say, a year ago?
Well, what's surprising is how fast this all happened. I mean, you used to take, you know, years to go through these market cycles, but now it takes weeks. I mean, in March, you saw a third of the stock market's value vanish in a couple of weeks, and then instantly they pump everything possible into it, and then you shoot back to new highs. I mean, you can't trade that. I mean, come on, this is too much volatility. You don't want to own that.
EB, with the minute we have left here, in your book, you speak about your grandfather being a great mentor to you when it comes to investing. Advice for our viewers watching that you'd like to share?
Yeah, I mean, buy your grandkid a copy of my book. I mean, it's written so that any person can understand it.
This is for my kids.
This is my journey in finance. I mean, I wrote newsletters. I've managed money. I'm on the board of Metalla Royalty. You know, I'm on the company is going public soon. Nova Royalty, I'm very involved with. It's nickel and copper royalties. I mean, these types of things, I'm writing about them so that people understand not just what I've done, but how I've done it. So in the book, as you know, I tell you exactly how I came to all these conclusions. And if you read the book and follow me along, you don't need me anymore, because at the end of it, you know how to think. And that's what my grandfather taught me, was how to think. And it's the most valuable gift you can give to someone that's growing up today, because the world they're entering is different from the world that we lived in.
No, we always need you, EB. And I always have a great time interviewing you. Your book, Why Gold, Why Now, available on Amazon.
Audible,
highly recommend you get
everywhere.
It.
Yeah, you can get it everywhere. Bookstores, Barnes and Noble, you name it. You can find it all over the place. A lot of people have read it, and it's helped a lot of people. And I think now's the time. Why gold? Why now? Not why gold? Why in a few years? Why gold? Why now?
All right. EB Tucker, I hope to see you in New York City soon.
Absolutely. Thanks so much.
And thank you for watching. We'll have much more for you. In the meantime, you can follow us on all our social media platforms. We're on Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, Twitter. We're all there. For Stansberry Research, I'm Daniela Cambone.